Thank you very much. So the question before us is there a crisis looming for central banks? And it's a great title to sort of grab people's attention and get them to turn up at 9 o'clock here on a Tuesday morning at the tail end of this parliament. But if you mean, are central banks going to go bankrupt, the answer is no. Central banks never go bankrupt. That's one of the fundamental things to realise about central banks. Nor do I believe that we are on the verge of another financial crisis remotely like 2007 to 2008, where one bank goes bankrupt and then we're worried about which one next is going to go in a sort of domino effect. But I do think that the global economy, and in particular the advanced economies, are still stuck in a chronically suboptimal position, suboptimal growth, which is going to continue unless we accept the need for a much more radical form of reform of our policies, both in relation to banking systems, the coordination of fiscal and monetary policy, and in particular in the Eurozone, various things to do with the structure of the Eurozone. And those required changes do amount to a significant change in what central banks have to do, and indeed in their theoretical basis, their understanding of what is money and the role that money plays in what economies. I think the starting point is to realise what a startlingly poor period of economic performance for the advanced economies, the decade from 2007 to 2017, has been. In the UK, GDP per capita is now only 1% higher than it was in 2007. And with some adverse distributional effects as well, the net effect is that real wages are actually lower than they were in 2017. If you look through the historical record, and we have reasonable figures of GDP per capita going back to about 1830, apart from wars, major wars, First and Second World War, there's no decade in which this has occurred before. So this is the first decade in modern capitalism where we fail to deliver, over a period of a decade, a significant increase in prosperity. And this has, as it were, broken the contract between capitalism and the people, because everybody knows that capitalism produces an unequal result. Some people get more than others. Everybody knows that capitalism has its ups and downs year by year. There are years where you go down and years where you recover. But the assumption is that by the time you get to a 10-year period, everybody will gain something from the growth of the economy, and that contract has been broken. And if you want to understand why there was a vote for Brexit, why there was a vote for Donald Trump, I think it has a lot to do with the breaking of that economic contract. That's true in the UK. In the Eurozone, GDP per capita is actually no higher, slightly below on average where it was in 2007. Even in the US, which has recovered better than other advanced economies, it's about 4% higher. 4% over an entire decade is an incredibly low rate of growth in an environment where we used to believe that advanced economies would grow at 1.5% or 2% per annum per capita growth. Now, why has this occurred? I think part of the explanations may lie on what we call the supply side of the economy. I think there are some very interesting things happening to long-term productivity growth rates, which we only imperfectly understand. And that is, as it were, a separate issue from what we want to discuss today. But part of the explanation is undoubtedly, I think, on the demand side of the economy. And it is the fact that for the last 10 years, central banks and treasuries together have struggled to create enough nominal demand in the economies. I think it's a reasonable hypothesis. It was part of the pre-crisis orthodoxy, but I think it's part of the orthodoxy which was a good one, that modern advanced economies work best with a growth of GDP per capita, nominal GDP per capita, of say 4 or 5% per annum, which enables you to combine a slow, low but positive inflation rate of maybe 2% per annum with a 2% growth rate. There's a reasonable hypothesis that if you go much higher than that, you may produce harmful inflation. If you go much lower than that, you will either have inflation too low or you'll have real growth rate too low. Well, the simple fact is that if you look at the advanced economies against that metric for the last 10 years, they've been falling far short. Even in the US, nominal GDP, so that's real growth plus inflation together, has been only 2.8% per annum. In the UK, it's been 2.7% per annum, and in the Eurozone, it's been 1.5% per annum. And on average across the world, the central banks have struggled to get inflation rate up to the targets that they've set themselves. We've been a bit of an exception for two periods, both after 2009 and today, because we've had higher than 2% inflation, but that's solely because we've had a significant devaluation of sterling. If you strip that out across most of the advanced economies, the problem has been how to achieve adequate inflation, and indeed these central banks have fallen far short of it. And they've fallen far short of it, despite the fact that they've done things which, if you'd told us what they were going to do in 2007, nobody would have believed you. People had said in 2007, interest rates are going to be at 0.5%, 0.25% negative for 10 years. And there's been going to be quantitative easing where we try to drive down long-term yield curves. They're going to do that for 10 years. What do you think the inflation rate is going to be in 2017? People said, oh my God, they've gone mad. It's going to be 10, it's going to be 15, it's going to be 20%. What has happened is quite extraordinary. The scale of monetary stimulus has not produced anything like the inflationary impetus that all our standard models would have expected back in 2007. So why is this occurring? Well, I think there are two main explanations, and I think they're complementary, not competitive. One is what we might call the debt overhang a explanation, and the other is the secular stagnation explanation. The debt overhang explanation is very well described in a rather good book called Between Debt and the Devil, Money, Credit, and Fixing Global Finance, available to all good booksellers. And it is the main theme of my book as to why have we been stuck in this situation. I think the absolute core of it is the excessive creation of private credit, which occurred not just in the few years before 2007, but over an entire half century before 2007. In 1950, private debt to GDP, so that's household and corporate together, as a percentage of global of advanced economy GDP, so we're concentrating on the advanced economies here, grew from 50% of GDP to 170% of GDP. And it grew every single year from 1950 to 2007, and at an accelerating pace after the 1990s. And almost all of that growth in credit was credit against real estate. There was an enormous increase in real estate. Indeed, one of the things that's been brilliantly pointed out in a series of articles by Oscar Yorda, Maurice Shorrock, and Alan Taylor is that what modern banking systems primarily do is lend money against real estate, and not even primarily lend money against property development, but essentially to fund the purchase of real estate that already exists. Now, the reason why that's problematic is that if real estate is to a degree fixed in supply, which to a degree it is, then when private banks lend money against real estate, the only thing that is likely to give is the price, and when the price goes up, both borrowers and lenders think that it would be a good idea to borrow some more money and lend some more money, so the price goes up more, and it goes round and round in a circle. And the circle goes on until there's a crack of confidence, and then the whole thing spins in the other direction. And those circles, which were well described by an economist called Hyman Minsky, who was almost entirely ignored in the years before crisis, turn out to be not just part of the story of what produces instability in modern economies. They are again and again pretty much the whole of the story. They're what goes wrong in Scandinavia in the late 80s and early 90s, they're what goes wrong in Japan in the late 80s, what goes wrong in Massachusetts and Texas in the late 80s, early 90s, and they're what goes wrong in 2007-8. And the problem is that if that crisis, that cycle of increasing lending against real estate pops and we move to a lack of confidence and a downward spiral, and if that occurs in a situation where we already have a large amount of debt, where our debt is 170% of GDP, we enter what I think is the situation where we have been for the last 10 years, that the debt never goes away. It simply moves around the economy from the private to the public sector or from one part of the world to another. What do I mean by it moves around the economy? Well, you can illustrate that by looking at Japan. Japan was the canary in the mine, which told us what was going to happen, and to an extraordinary extent, economists ignored it because they just thought, well, Japan's different, it can't tell us anything. But actually, what's happened in the advanced economies, the rest of the advanced economies since 2008, is pretty much a carbon copy of what happened in Japan after 1990. In the 1980s, Japan had, as it were, the mother of all credit and real estate booms. Credit extended against real estate multiplied about four times in 5 years. Price of real estate went up four times. Confidence breaks in 1990. And you have a whole lot of over-leveraged companies, and in Japan's case, it's primarily companies rather than households, who feel that they're over-leveraged. And they then become determined to pay down debt. And they become determined to pay down debt, crucially, even if the central bank moves the interest rate close to zero. And that is what was going on in Japan throughout the 1990s, attempted deleveraging by the private sector of the economy. In that environment, public deficits go up. And they go up automatically and usefully, because the attempt of the private sector to deleverage, to pay down its debt, means cuts in investment, cuts in consumption. That drives the economy into a recession. Tax revenues go down, public expenditure goes up. The public sector runs a deficit. And if I was to show you the chart, but you can read it in a very good book, it will illustrate that throughout the 1990s, the corporate sector of Japan, rather than being a net borrower from the other sectors of the economy, is a net saver. The government runs deficits. Those deficits are useful. Without them, I think Japan would have gone into a far deeper, real big depression. But the net effect is that the debt doesn't go away. It simply moves around. And over 25 years, corporate debt to GDP in Japan has gone down from 150% debt to GDP to 100%, and public debt has gone up from 50% to 250%, and is still rising. And the total amount of debt, private and public together, as a percent of GDP, has just relentlessly risen. Debt doesn't go away, it moves around the economy, and the total slowly goes up. And if you look at the figures, that is exactly what has happened across the world since 2008. In the advanced economies, there has been a small amount, particularly in the US, but to a small extent elsewhere, of private sector deleveraging. Private debt as a percent of GDP has come down in a small amount, but in almost every developed economy there has been a more than offsetting increase in public debt as a percent of GDP. And as been shown, you can look at it in the Bank for International Settlements long-term database on debt. The total amount of debt, public and private combined, across the world is now higher than ever. The debt has just gone up. It has also gone up between countries, or it has shifted between countries. One of the most dramatic things that's happened over the last 7 years is an unbelievable growth of debt in China. In China, it's actually quite difficult to work out whether you should count it private or public, because there's a whole lot of sort of quasi-state organizations. But if you took the two together, it's gone up from something like 150% to approaching 300% of GDP. And that growth of debt in China has not just been circumstantial, that it isn't just that it's occurred while we're facing this crisis. The one caused the other. What happened in early 2009 is that the Chinese authorities were terrified that attempted deleveraging by American consumers hitting the brakes because they had too much debt would drive the American economy into recession, drive a reduction in Chinese exports, and to offset that, the Chinese authorities unleashed an enormous credit-fueled investment boom, which has kept the Chinese economy going, but at the expense of a huge increase of debt. Now, the problem in this environment is that you eventually get into a situation where the debt goes up, and it appears that all of our policy tools are either imperfect or have adverse side effects. What do I mean by that? Well, in the immediate aftermath of the crisis, when you first realize that you're in this situation, everybody agrees that we should run fiscal deficits. And the first order effect of fiscal deficits, the first round effects, is undoubtedly stimulative. So here in London, in April 2009, the G20, all the countries of the world agreed we should run coordinated large fiscal deficits to offset the fact that there's been a financial crisis and the private sector is trying to deleverage. And that occurred. But after a while, people say, yes, but what am I going to do about the fact that public debt is now rising? I better have austerity to control that. I can't just allow public debt to go from 50% to 250% debt to GDP. But if you then enter a situation where the public sector is trying to delever, is trying to have austerity, while the private sector is still delevering, you will really go into a deep depression unless you believe that monetary policy is so powerful that it can offset it. And what emerged from about 2009-2010 onwards was, as it were, the post-crisis consensus that we had to get control over the public deficits, but that we could fully offset this by these amazingly powerful central banks, which would use negative interest rates and quantitative easing to offset the effect of the beginning of the tightening of fiscal policy. But the problem with that is that monetary policy alone is, I believe, in these environments, ineffective or imperfectly effective, and has adverse side effects. What do I mean by ineffective? Well, the primary transmission mechanism of monetary policy is meant to be you reduce the interest rate, and then somebody says, well, I'll borrow a bit more and I'll invest a bit more. But when interest rates are already very low, and if lots of people already have a high level of debt, it turns out that behavior is incredibly inelastic in response to interest rates. Last March, the ECB launched a new round of quantitative easing, and that took the German 10-year bond yield, the government bond yield, down from 20 basis points to 10 basis points. That will also have reduced the cost of borrowing for major German corporates by 10 basis points. I will find a 0.1%, 1/10%. I will define a single German company which, faced with a reduction of the cost of borrowing of 0.1%, when already at the lowest level that it had been, you know, for decades, went out and invested what I owe to all. It's just not that interest rate elastic. So people say, oh, well, no, that's not the mechanism. The mechanism is asset price increases. We decrease the interest rate, we use quantitative easing, down goes the long-term government bond yield, bonds go up in value, equities go up in value, housing goes up in value, and then people feel a bit more confident and they spend a bit more. And the answer is that may work to a degree, a very indirect way to attempt to stimulate the economy. It's a sort of wealth trickle-down effect. It doesn't clearly have a transmission mechanism to investment and consumption. No, it probably works eventually. But it also has a very significant effect of increasing inequality. And this is well shown in a very fine article by Andy Haldane, chief economist of the Bank of England, in a speech he gave in June last year called Who's Recovery, where he illustrates that since 2007, real wages have been completely flat and wealth has gone up 40%. It's not surprising if you have incredibly low real interest rates, which then drive up the value of equities and property and bonds. But if, as I believe, and I won't explore this, but I think it's an important subbit of the story, if, as I believe, one of the reasons why we created so much debt in the first place was as a reaction to rising inequality, because when you have rising inequality, you may need debt to make the economy balance. If that is the case, it's a bit ironic that the only way we can find out of it is to create some more inequality. So the final transmission mechanism that central banks talk about in terms of very low, ultra-loose monetary policy is they talk about the currency effect. And if you read the speeches of Mario Draghi or Kuroda-san in Japan, it often seems that they think this ultra-loose monetary policy will reduce the value of the euro and the yen, and then there'll be an external demand stimulus effect. But the trouble with that is that can work for one country that's got into a debt-induced mess in a growing world economy. Broadly speaking, that's what Sweden and the other Scandinavian economies did within the mid-1990s, and they were sufficiently small relative to the rest of the world that it worked. But if a whole world has too much debt, we cannot get out of a global debt overhang problem by devaluing all of our currencies simultaneously against those of Jupiter and Mars and Venus, etc. That is not an available strategy. So my belief is that this monetary policy alone cannot be effective. I'll come back to what I think has stimulated the economy at the end of the day, but monetary policy alone, I think, in a deflationary debt trap, is not effective. And that goes way back to Keynes's insight that, as he put it, under some circumstances you are pushing on a string with monetary policy if you've already got too much debt, or a great book by a man called Richard Koo on balance sheet recessions, an interpretation of what happened in Japan. So, I think we are in a big problem as a result of a debt overhang. The other factor, very quickly, is what's called secular stagnation. I would ask you to look at one set of facts. If you look at what is the real yield to maturity, so it's the maturity on an index-linked bond, what you get, inflation-adjusted, for a UK government 10-year index-linked bond, average over five-year period, starting 1985 to 90, and then we're going to roll forward five-year periods thereafter, the yield to maturity you will get is 3.85%, 3.59%, 2.54%, 1.95%, 1.22%, and it's now minus 1.8%. The real yield to maturity has just gone like that for 25 years. And when you see a trend like that in economics, you sort of tend to believe that that can't be due to a particular twist of monetary policy or a particular crisis. There has to be something long-term, secular, as we call it, going on. And there is a reasonable hypothesis put forward by Larry Summers and explored well, for instance, a very good paper by Rachel Smith of the Bank of England last December. There is a reasonable hypothesis that the reason why this has occurred is that we live in a world where there is an imbalance between attempted savings and attempted investment. Post-facto savings has to equal investment, but anti-facto there can be more attempted savings than there is investment, and then the interest rate has to fall in order to produce balance. And it may be that we live in a world where attempted savings is overwhelming attempted investment, and economies only balance with incredibly low real interest rates, which then create major problems. I won't go through the set of hypothesis candidates for that in detail, but for a set of reasons, a combination of demography, rising inequality, and the way that information and communication technology makes it possible to grow economies with very little capital investment, essentially because computers and software are too cheap, all of those together can produce this situation. So, put all that together, there's a debt overhang, certainly. There's a reasonable hypothesis of what Summers has called a secular stagnation. And we end up with a situation where by early 2017, there was a lot of conversation out there among central banks, among economists, that we were literally stuck. That we were stuck with these low rates of nominal GDP growth, below the 4 or 5% that we think is reasonable. We were stuck with inflation below target, and that we could do nothing about it. If you look at the Economist headline from mid-February last year, 2016, it was a central banker with a bazooka, and there's nothing coming out of it, and the question was, out of ammo, question mark. Are we out of ammunition? Do we literally enter a stage where there is nothing that you can do to get nominal demand going? And that is an interesting question in economics. Can you enter a situation where you want to have higher rates of inflation, you want higher real growth, but you'd be happy even to have a higher rate of inflation, but you can't get it. Can you ever run out of ammunition? The answer is no, you can't. There are very few problems in economics to which there is a definitive solution. But if you are stuck in a situation where nominal GDP is lower than you want, that is a problem which you can always solve. Now, to solve it, you have to break the taboo. And people don't like breaking taboos, but it's called monetary finance. If in those circumstances you run fiscal deficits and you monetize them, i.e. the central bank buys the debt and writes it off so that it isn't a debt, you will stimulate nominal demand. Now the reason why that's a taboo subject is that the world is full of historical examples where we've done that and we've overdone it. because there is a problem that once you tell politicians that this is possible, they might want to do it all the time, in large amounts, in inappropriate circumstances in the run-up to an election, rather than small, moderate amounts only in situations of a debt overhang. But it is important to realise that it is possible, that it is doable. And there are some examples in economic history where it has been done responsibly, in particular, for instance, the early 1930s in Japan, where Finance Minister Takahashi used monetary finance completely effectively to pull Japan more rapidly out of a recession than the other countries. Unfortunately, Takahashi was a very, very responsible man. In 1935, he said, we've done enough of that, we're going to pull a stop to that, I'm beginning to worry we might be overdoing it due to inflation, and the military assassinated him because they didn't want to give up on military expenditure. So you can read Takahashi either way, either as illustrating the technical possibility of monetary finance or the political risks and moral hazards of monetary finance. But it is technically possible. And the interesting thing is that, in a sense, I think we're sort of doing that. Because even though we haven't broken the taboo, you can sort of do monetary finance without admitting that you're doing monetary finance. One of the interesting questions is fiscal policy, you know, is it effective in stimulating demand? The reason why it might not be effective in stimulating demand is three reasons. If you're talking about debt finance, fiscal policy, you run a deficit and you issue debt. It might be ineffective because after a while you politically worry about all that debt that's accumulating, so you stop doing it. It might be ineffective because the people know that you're going to do that, and that's called Ricardian equivalence. They anticipate that there's going to be future inequality. Or it might be ineffective because there's what's called crowding out. You're trying to issue all this debt, and when you try and issue all this debt, the interest rate goes up and that crowds out private activity. Those are the sort of three reasons why a debt-financed fiscal deficit might not be effective. But if you run a debt-financed fiscal deficit and at the same time your central bank is buying the debt in huge quantities, you won't have crowding out because that will keep the long-term interest rate down. And it may be that people realise that that monetization might be permanent. Because who knows whether it would be permanent or not. It might be a signal that there really isn't a constraint there. One of the most interesting articles recently produced in economic theory, I think, was by Christopher Sims at last year's Jackson Hole Symposium of Central Bankers. And he basically argued that in a deep deflationary situation, monetary policy works if it is applied in association with fiscal policy, and only in association with fiscal policy. And that essentially, in a deep recession, what you do is you run large deficits and you run large quantitative easing operations. Now, central bankers don't like to admit this because that's getting close to breaking the taboo. It is accepting that what they are doing is lubricating and facilitating large fiscal deficits. And they don't like to admit that. What they like to say is that their quantitative easing operations are working through purely monetary mechanisms. I think that purely monetary mechanisms are ineffective, and I think that monetary policy, insofar as it has been effective, has worked entirely and only because it has facilitated large fiscal deficits. I think that is, as it were, the dirty little secret of what has been going on for the last 5 years. I think our economies have essentially been kept going via fiscal deficits. If you look at the relationship between the size of the fiscal deficit and nominal GDP over the last 6 years, you will find a strong correlation. The Eurozone has had the smallest growth of nominal GDP per annum at about 1.8% because it has had the smallest fiscal deficits at about 3 or 4% of GDP on average. The US has had the fastest rate, still inadequate, but the fastest rate of nominal GDP growth at about 2.8% because it has run on average deficits about 7%. Much bigger deficits in the Eurozone, much bigger deficits than us, and that is what has kept the American economy going. And I think the reason why the global economy is growing better than this year is also because there had been a set of fiscal relaxations without us quite noticing it. One of the first groups of people to notice that there might be some a development of the advanced economy growth rate this year was the OECD in its November forecast at the end of last year. And in that, they were absolutely explicit that three things were going on: fiscal relaxations. Small fiscal relaxations in the Eurozone periphery, where they sent countries like Portugal and Spain were basically being more courageous about ignoring what the Commission was saying. A big fiscal relaxation last year in China. And just by the way, throughout the world, people don't pay enough attention to what's going on in China. China is now a $12 trillion economy. What happens in China, whether it relaxes fiscal policy or tightens fiscal policy, hugely important. And in 2016, there was an enormous stimulus to fiscal policy in China, and also a relaxation of private credit creation. Again, with the caveat that in China, what you count as private credit and what you count as fiscal deficits is a bit thing. And there was some relaxation of the US fiscal stance last year, and there was an expectation that there would be a further relaxation of the fiscal stance with Donald Trump this year, with his great infrastructure program and tax cuts. So anybody who believes that they know what is going to happen next with Donald Trump is in a peculiar fantasy realm. So the reason why the global economy is not going is fiscal relaxation, which has been stimulated, supported by monetary policy. Very briefly, what's going to happen now? Japan is going to permanently monetize debt. Japan has a public debt of about 250% of GDP. About 100% of GDP of that, 40% of that debt, is owned by the Bank of Japan. And one can argue about what should happen, but I'm willing to take a bet. I'll make a significant bet. I'll make £1,000 with anyone in this room, and we'll settle it in 2030, that there are no states of the world whatsoever in which Japan is going to repay that public debt in the normal sense of the word repay, and no states of the world whatsoever in which that 100% of GDP currently owned by the Bank of Japan is ever going to be sold back to the private sector, where there is going to be a reversal of Japanese quantitative easing. This is going to turn out to be a permanent monetization of Japanese government debt, and it's not going to produce hyperinflation. So Japan is going through an experiment in which it is doing a monetization exercise, and it is the right thing to do in Japan. The US economy will grow at a reasonable pace. I have no idea whether post facto some of the quantitative easing will turn out to be permanent. It may not. That may not be necessary. It may be that a freely developing dynamic of the US economy gets going, private credit gets going again, and you won't see a permanent monetization there, which you might. As for the Eurozone, I think, still has a fundamental problem. When I give talks like this in Germany, German colleagues say to me, well, we hear a dare about this debt-fueled boom which is going on throughout the world, and clearly that is unsustainable. But the one place where you don't get debt-fueled booms is Germany. We don't have debt. And I have to tell you, well, yes, you do have debt, but it's just that the debt is in other countries. Because when you run an 8% current account surplus, you are reliant on somebody else somewhere in the rest of the world piling up debt. And the German economy would not be growing at the rate it is growing if it wasn't that the Chinese were piling up unsustainable debt, which is what they are doing. The Eurozone, I think, is an imperfect monetary union, which does not have the flexibility, which the US has illustrated, to run fiscal deficits at the federal level when it is in a recession. As a result, I think it has dangerously unresolved debt problems, particularly in Italy. And another debt, the bet, you ain't seen the end of Italian government debt problems. I do not think that Italian government debt is sustainable, and I think we could well be within the next 5 to 10 years into debates about Italian government debt, which are similar to those that we have about Greek debt, and the needs for either restructure or write-offs or some sort. So, in sum, where are we? We have too much debt in the world, and we need to return to the basics of where nominal demand comes from. Nominal demand, I think, ultimately comes. It's a complicated thing because nominal demand can sort of self-create itself out of confidence and various quasi-forms of money that we create between ourselves by being willing to deal with each other on credit. The issue of what is money is really, which positive money had done some great work on, is one of the real deep issues in economics. But essentially, you can think about nominal demand growth is coming from two things. Either private banks create nominal demand. And the most important thing to understand about private banks is that they don't take pre-existing money and lend it on. They create credit, money, and purchasing power, which did not previously exist. That was the great insight of the Austrian school of people like Friedrich Hayek, and it got ignored and lost to a lot of economic theory after 1960. But essentially, you can create nominal demand out of a private credit and banking system, but you can overcreate it, or you can direct it towards the purchase of existing assets rather than new investments. So that's one way you can get nominal demand. And you can also get nominal demand because governments, essentially, run deficits, which eventually they sort of monetize. And again, I think that is the dirty little secret, that eventually they increase the monetary base in a way which has sort of created. You shouldn't be shocked by that. A lot of very responsible people like Milton Friedman talk completely openly about it. But those fundamental determinants of nominal demand are things that we need to return to the basics of theory. And I think the central banks of the world are a long way from returning to those basics of theory. I think we have lived in a world in which we have over-anchorized, been overconfident about private credit creation. We believe that whatever the private system does must be optimal because, well, it would be optimal because it's a free market. But that's not true because financial markets are subject to all sorts of inefficiencies. So our private credit creation processes can run out of control and produce asset bubbles and then post-asset bubble deflations. And in the post-environment, we get too worried. I mean, sometimes legitimately worried, but I think too worried about the fact that the way to get out of it involves the role of the state, ultimately, in running fiscal deficits and, in some sense, quasi-monetizing them. But that is, of course, the work of the devil, which is why the title of my rather good book is The Devil. Thank you very much.
Despite the fact that the Bank of England is created out of nothing £445 billion, and in fact more because of the maturing of funds each year. This hasn't led to an increase in spending or borrowing or investment of UK businesses. It hasn't improved the current account deficit. And despite the fact that the private sector is essentially paying the government to borrow, then the government is still committed to fiscal austerity, or at least very limited increases in fiscal spending. And at the same time, we know that QE has increased wealth inequality. As I said, Andy Haldane of Bank of England's research has shown that that was, has led to the top 5% of households becoming richer by £128,000. And since QE was expanded in 2016 after Brexit, corporate QE has been added to the mix. So this is where Bank of England hits corporations of which the private is funded, which is of course controversial and leads to some serious questions about how monetary and fiscal policy work together. Former MPC member David Blanchwell called it unmandated fiscal policy. So both Bank of England and the European Central Bank are buying, are choosing which companies to buy bonds in. Carney's explanation for this was that he was going to choose companies which made a material difference to the UK economy. So I'm sure you were also shocked when he announced the list of corporations including Apple, AT&T and others. I would say possibly a material difference. But there's clearly a limit to how much short-term activity was the Bank of England could pull in the face of real long-term challenges that face the UK. And those include the fact that we're growing our economy, our consumer debt and borrowing, and asset price inflation, both of which were key factors in what led to the financial crash. And Chief Economist Andy Haldane at the bank has said that the biggest risk to financial stability in the UK is the unsustainable levels of private sector debt. So even with asset prices keeping asset prices pushed up, there's serious doubts over how long it's going to last, and not to mention the undesirable effects of that process. Alongside this, we've had 7 years of fiscal austerity, which has obviously been a huge role in heavy demand, falling wages, and that's been met with a high cost of living. However, even with potential end of austerity, although that doesn't actually look too likely, this is no more than the Bank of England and other central banks would be doing. We have EBS. And hopefully there are some MPs of parliamentarians in this room, and you need to recognise that the tools being used by the Bank of England in both monetary as well as macroprudential policy have huge implications for this traditional wealth and knock-on effects for a range of social and environmental issues. For example, quantitative easing has inflated house prices, which has exacerbated the housing crisis. And Mark Carney recently defended his decision to buy bonds in fossil fuel companies, despite the fact that he's been signalling to financial markets of the risks of climate change. So too often we found in our work with politicians, really think that monetary policy and what banks have done is outside of their remit, and they don't need to worry about it. As an example, when QE was being deployed, only 15 MPs raised questions about it in the House. That compares to over 100 that raised questions on the deficit. Now, the deficit could have been covered by QE about 3 times over. So it's a serious amount of money we need to worry about. There's been more or less a cross-party consensus around monetary policy that we should just let the bank get on with it. But that consensus is clearly breaking. And we're really pleased to see some important MPs waking up to this issue. We were thrilled when the Treasury Select Committee announced an inquiry into monetary policy at the beginning of the year. And we really hope that under the new leadership of Nicky Morgan, they're going to pick up that inquiry, because it's really important. We also think it's time for Bank of England to take leadership in this conversation about mandates and tools. So positive money, alongside the Turner, have been actively calling for a new tool to be considered, monetary policy. This is by creating money, not dissimilar to QE, but spending it through the government, directly contributing to boosting demand, jobs and wages. Now there was a pretty impressive and substantial review done by the Treasury in 2013 on the monetary policy framework, which laid out clear reasoning for the continued consideration of unconventional monetary policy tools, and actually included monetary financing in that. They referenced a speech that Adair gave in 2012. So they have, in fact, given permission by government to be looking into this policy. In the same report, they laid out the justification for setting up a financial policy committee, which looks into macro prudential policy, a really important step for the banks risk crash. They understand now that the biggest risk facing financial stability is the system. You can't look at an individual bank per se. But we're now 4 years on from that review, and arguably in a much worse economic situation or uncertain. With Brexit, savings ratios at the lowest level in the UK since records began, and private and public sector being up. I think it's time for Bank of England to be investigating and designing a rule-based overt monetary financing tool. Private and public debt's rising, it does seem that a form of monetary financing is inevitable somewhere in the world over the next few years. But that doesn't mean it will be carried out in a transparent way or even in the best way for society. When QE was conceived, it was not really scrutinised at all by Parliament. There was very little public debate, it just kind of happened because it was the best move they were in a hurry. And I think that we need to have these ideas discussed now before we need to use these tools in an emergency. Currently, central banks, well, at least the Bank of England, European Central Bank, and the Fed, do, really don't want to be seen as political. They want to be seen as neutral, technocratic institutions. But I just don't think that's possible anymore in the current economic climate. Doing nothing different or staying the same is just as big a decision and a political decision as changing course. And whether they like it or not, they are making decisions which are inherently political, like increasing the wealth of the top 10% in the UK by hundreds of thousands of pounds, or deciding to select a few companies, including fossil fuel companies, that will benefit from cheaper borrowing costs through corporate QE. That's political. But simply, if the Bank of England is going to create hundreds of billions of pounds of new money, it's a political question where that money should go. And it's a question that should be decided by the Treasury overseen by the Parliament. And that is monetary financing. So in response to the 2008 crisis, it's been to increase the wealth of those who already have assets and to hope that that will increase spending and will trickle down to the rest of us. But our response to the next crisis must be to direct money into the things the UK economy needs. Infrastructure, green technology, social housing, and many more things. And just to end on a radical note, because that's my job to be radical, I think essentially the Bank of England was founded to bring the issuance of money and credit into public control. And in 1694, that was essentially to fund a war. If we think about the challenges we face over the next few decades, the challenges my generation needs to sort out, that's declining productivity gains, unprecedented intergenerational wealth inequalities, climate change, rising economic and political instability. And I really hope that politicians, central bankers, and everyone that's involved in thinking about the big questions will start to realise that the conversation we're having right now is a radical enough.
Well, good morning. The hour is getting late, so I'll edit these comments on the booth to give you time for questions. I want to make three points. The first is, yes, central banks are in trouble and may lose their independence, and this is to be welcomed. Second, a lot of the problem we have in this country is that finance is overmighty and too large, and it should be shrunk. And the third is that ultimately, neoliberal economics has run its course and will or should be overturned. So I could sit down now, or I could try and just say what it essentially, to take the point about welcoming the demise of central banks, essentially, the economic model we have, as Adair said, is that growth is roughly 4.5%. The goal of the central banks would be to cope with shocks that came along. It would lean against the shocks to keep the growth rate on trend. And it lent against the shocks essentially by adjusting the interest rate, which changed consumption patterns. If things were bad, it sought to lower interest rates to bring tomorrow's spending forward to today. And if things were overheating, it tried to delay spending by putting up rates and delaying today's spending till tomorrow. And that's all that basically, I'm a simple economist, or at least I have a couple of equipment in simple terms, but that's essentially the mechanism. Now, the problem that we have is that this works in the short term, but it doesn't work in the long term. And what we have in the world is a fundamental structural problem, which is beyond the ability of central bank tools to resolve. And the central problem that we have in this world, the reason it has, as it were, dislocated, has been the rise of China, because in the past, the world has been able to accommodate small growing economies expanding and joining the rich nations, albeit very few of them actually have managed to get all the way through. But when something of the scale and size of China comes along and becomes rich, or certainly wealthy, in the time it did, it has dislocated the entire financial system. The world is too small. The lifeboat in which we were has got too crowded and become extremely unstable. I'm not saying this should not have happened, but it has happened. And essentially, we have the world has become destabilized by the imbalances that go up, the huge Chinese surpluses and huge German surpluses. And these imbalances, in other words, money which is accumulated as reserves and not being absorbed by investment for various reasons, these imbalances have caused a deficiency of demand. And this deficiency of demand, as my summits and others have explained, is why the world is not working properly. And asking central banks to cope with or to overcome with their limited tools a demand deficiency on the scale in which we face is asking too much. It is not that they lack the willingness or the ability, but they have been asked to do too much. And because they have had to overcompensate, we now have all the side effects of which we are concerned with. Build up of the debt mountain, the inequality, all those other bad things. But it's wrong to blame the central banks for this because we were asking to do an impossible job. And it seems to me that the only way, if this can be resolved at all, is on a global level by politicians getting together and fundamentally trying to address the form of imbalances in Germany, in Japan, and in the United States and elsewhere. And this is obviously way beyond the competence or the ability or the mandate of any central bank. It is a political issue. And my concern about central bank independence and leaving it to the central banks to sort these things out is it's giving the politicians an escape card. It is allowing them not to focus on what is ultimately the pressing issue of our time, but they delegated to the central banks. And so we are continuing in this in this whirlpool of activity, which is actually not getting simpler. I'm not saying that the politicians could solve the problem, but I'm saying that the only hope of the problem being solved is in the hands of politicians, not in the hands of, or I should say statesmen, actually, which can be more than even the politicians. It is not something central banks or central banking or the financial system can resolve on its own. I fear that, that in the absence of political action, we will get a monumental clash at some point. And only after that kitchen door, the human cost involved, will things ultimately move forward. One would hope to avoid that, but it may be the case. I think the second point I want to make is that finance is, or the financial world is part of the problem, not part of the solution. And we're having this conversation about central banks largely because of the overmighty subject that is the financial sector. Finance is essentially about moving money from where it is to where it's needed. That's what the financial system is for. And it's supposed to be there as a servant of the real economy, and the problem here in this country and elsewhere is that finance has become an end in itself. You make money by moving money, not by what that money does. And somebody not a million miles from there who wrote a brilliant book did once ask that finance was perhaps not socially useful. And he had a good point. Paul, Woolley, who runs the Centre for the Study of Capital Markets, is functioning. A brilliant title. You don't actually need to know what they do. At the London School of Economics, has made the point that he thinks finance could be one-third of its size in the UK, and there would be no economic loss, that all the duties of finance should be properly fulfilled. And my own sort of simple example is that 40 years ago when I first went for a mortgage, I went to a building society, opened a savings account, then access my slate and asked for a mortgage, and it's a one-on-one reaction. When my son, 40 years on, goes to get a mortgage, he goes to an IFA, who goes to a broker, who goes to the market, who finds someone, and eventually, you know, after several more links in the chain, the money comes to him. But whereas I got a 25-year mortgage, he gets one for 3 years, so he then has to flip and do it all over again. Now, I would argue that an awful lot of that intermediation is not actually delivered. The person who's getting the mortgage, a singular benefit. There are many more miles fed in that chain, but one could perhaps condense it back to where we were before, and the world would not actually be a significantly worse place, albeit a lot of people would have private jobs. But my point in this is not to attack the city. My point is that because finance is so powerful in this country, policy has to cater for what the markets want, not for what society or the country wants. And you see it with all the talk of the withdrawal of property easing in the States and here and elsewhere, that the reaction is all, well, how will the markets behave? Will the markets tolerate this? And we seem to have got the cart massively before the horse, because the point of the markets ultimately is to help the economy, not to actually dictate policy. And so I think until we actually some find a way to reduce the power of finance, then we are going to be locked in this time. And my final point is that essentially, again, we're having this point, or this belief in monetary policy is ultimately a reflection of the neoliberal economic settlement that came in with the Thatcher 30 odd years ago. And I'm not saying that is a good or a bad thing, but I would say that if, and this was work done by George Business School and Professor Gutchen and others came out a couple of years ago, that if you actually look at the UK's economic performance from the 30 years before Thatcher and the 30 years since, the 30 years before were massively better on any metric you care to imagine. The growth was faster, employment was higher, incomes grew faster, investment was bigger, and the return on assets and profitability was better. That's not to say you can't keep counterfactual. So I don't know how bad it would have been if we hadn't had this section, but it wasn't quite as bad before as conventional wisdom would have to make out. And it may well be that whatever benefits came from neoliberalism over the last 30 years, perhaps again it's time that we think, perhaps it's time that it's run its course, perhaps it's time that we did decide that there are other ways of running an economy, there are broader approaches that can be taken, which plays to a lot of what I think Adair said, the marrying of monetary and fiscal policy, or the need for both, not the need for what Nigel Lawson of all people, I think, once called a one-club author. Was it technically? Certainly, it's a long time ago, but another lesson that's been forgotten in recent time. That monetary policy is very good for what it does, but don't expect it to do too much. And we have expected it too much, and we're giving the consequences. Thank you.
And Charter of the Forest 800. I can appreciate that the monetizing deficits will kick the ball down the road for a considerable amount of time. Isn't it actually obfuscating the need for a real redistribution of wealth and income back towards the direction it was, say, 40 or 50 years ago? Is there not a limit? Maybe Lord Turner or his employer would consider this, to the carrying capacity of the economy for more than a very small number of billionaires and centibillionaires, the ink, the debt and rent which they're taking from the rest of us.
Thank you very much. We have a question in front of you. the front row. Yes.
Stephen Green. I think for Adair, probably, this is a very technical question. How important is a destabilising factor do you think foreign ownership of domestically generated debt, public or private, has been? And is the answer different from for America than for the others? And is it getting worse or better?
Yeah, thank you. Adair, I think you
My analysis of debt primarily focuses on what would be true even in a closed economy. An economy which doesn't have an external sector, so we don't need to ask whether the debt is owned by other people or not. You know, many of the debt dynamics that I've talked about can be seen on primarily in those closed economy domestic terms. For instance, in the development of the Japanese credit boom and then bust of the late 90s and early 90s, the vast majority of that credit is created domestically, it's held domestically, and it still produces a crisis. Clearly, at the other end of the spectrum, and there was nothing about the Japanese debt crisis of the 1990s which has to do with foreign exchange imbalances or capital that flows in going out. Clearly, at the other end of the spectrum, you have relatively small economies, highly owned trading economies, where our debt crises have a lot to do with the fact that the debt might be foreign and that the debt might be in foreign exchange. So if you want to understand what happened in Thailand in 1987, it has a lot to do with a group of people lending money in dollars to Thai property developers who then have a set of rental streams which are in Thai bonds against a dollar debt and a thing that creates a crisis. So I think there is a sort of spectrum from, as it were, a Thailand through to a Japan. And at the extreme of that, of course, is the interesting situation of America, because a lot of America's debt, the vast majority is still domestic, but some of it is external. And part of what happens, and Anthony talked about it, in the period before the crisis is an accumulation of Chinese surpluses, the offset of which is American debt. But America is in this special position, as I think Mr. Giscard established, as this was said, it doesn't absorb the privilege, which is that it can borrow from the rest of the world, but in dollars. So when it borrows, it has large external debt. It does not create a foreign exchange risk, such as Thailand risks. So I think the whole foreign ownership of debt is an extra complication. And I think Britain is a very interesting intermediate. I mean, we're not as big as the US, we don't have exorbitant privilege, but we're not as small as Thailand, we are quite a big economy. I think the extent to which we are somewhat reliant on a debt which is funded overseas, which is the counterpart of our current capital deficit, we should be somewhat concerned about. I think you've got to address two things simultaneously. One, when you've got into a mess, what do you do about it? And I think you should include the tool of monetizing debt. Let me be absolutely explicit how I would do that. I would not give the control of that to the Treasury. I would give the control of the Treasury how to spend it, but I would do precisely what Ben Bernanke proposed in a Brookings Institute blog in April last year, which is to pass a law which gives to the central bank, the Bank of England, the right to decide that at a particular point in time, our best way to stimulate nominal demand would be to run a defined amount of unfunded money finance fiscal deficit. And I personally think that if we had had that law in place, it would be in a better position for the Monetary Policy Committee back in, say, 2009 to authorize, let's say, a 50 billion slice of unfunded additional fiscal deficit rather than 400 billion of apparently, supposedly, reversible QE. So that's specifically, you know, how I would propose to do it and how I would address the political risk. To your point about, yes, but is that just dealing with it? You have to deal with problems once you're in it. I think your point about, is there a fundamental problem with inequality is something that we do have to take seriously. I think there are some fundamental features of the modern economy of information, communication, technology in particular, which are probably creating an inherent underlying trend to increasing inequality. I think we've made that worse by, in the face of trends that are going that way anyway, rather than leaning a bit the other way through our progressive income tax system, we've broadly speaking tended to dismantle the progressivity of the income tax system, much more dramatically than the US than here. And I think it then does play into the monetary policy and macro demand situation. And I think this is most dramatically true in the US, and I think it may be partly true here. I think in the US, so much wealth has got concentrated into the hands of the top 5%, top 1%. A group of people who have a high marginal propensity to save, essentially because they've already got everything they need in life, so where would they save for? And you end up with a system which only balances if the savings of an increasingly rich minority at the top are picked up by the financial system and lent to middling, low-income earners who are attempting to make up by debt for the fact that their real wages are stagnant. And I think that is part of the problem that happened in the US. It's well described by Rahul Rajan, formerly chief economist of the IMF, then Reserve Bank governor in India, who in his very fine book, Fall Banks, has a great chapter on this with the fantastic title, Let Them Eat Credit. And I think fundamentally what happened in America was an explosion in inequality, which the American political system could produce no answer other than Let Them Eat Credit, and it blew up. So yes, I do think we have to take seriously the issue of rising inequality and find ways to offset it.
Thank you. Adair, at the beginning, you separated out the supply side and the demand side. But from the discussion I've heard, doing things on the demand side is essentially at the fringes. And is the real solution on the supply side? I mean, have we come to, as it were, for developed countries, the end, if you like, of the third industrial revolution, and the consumer demand that can stimulate, which means a real commitment now to the fourth industrial revolution as a mechanism for going forward. And in the UK, sort of in a very practical sense, the blockage that's of house prices, just simply biting the bullet and investing in a major house building programme for affordable housing, just as we did after the Second World War.
My name is Liam Kelly, I'm a housing consultant. My question is for the panel. Why is and why has house price inflation been excluded from the official figures? Is that a good thing?
Okay, two questions. Who would like to start?
I think we think that there's a problem with consumer price inflation not taking into account housing, considering it's the biggest cost of most people and most people's income, both especially in London. So I think that there is, even though we've got the MNC and currently the bank understand that they need to be worried about empty numbers, I think there's still a big bit of a conversation that's happening around the thing. We never discuss it by what they say.
I think there are really two, at least two, very big failures of modern economic three result. Fixation with efficient markets, which was a mistake. But there is a failure to understand the nature of money. But there is also a failure to pay enough attention to housing and property and land. We teach economists what's called a two-factor model of production functions, which is labor and capital. And we teach them that capital in the second year is capital in the first year, must be the lesson which occurs in the intervening period. Actually, if you look at the figures of the great database offices, Thomas McKetty in the capital of the first century, the majority of capital in modern economy funds, and all of the increase in the wealth to income ratio, which we get to, but not the present, is due to land. And land, which was essential to the economics of David Ricardo, he had a different one on land, he had a little labor. Again, it disappears from our economics about 30 or 40 years ago. So, what happens to land prices? And let's realize the top end, you know, of the urban housing, it's all land. I'm very lucky. My house has gone up in value since I bought it in 1994 about five times. So, that's absolutely nothing to do with me putting in some double glazing and a new boiler. It's all a relatively small chunk of land on which it sits as sword in hand. So, this issue of land is fundamental. It's also fundamental to some measurement issues about GDP. We do count rent in GDP, and rent has gone from about 6% of GDP to 12% of GDP. But if rent goes up simply because the value of rent's gone up, there's no extra pot of goods and services for people to consume, but it's in GDP. So there are some really deep issues about that. Your point about should we have it in house price? Well, you should certainly look at house price inflation. On the whole, I would tend to think it still makes sense to look separately at inflation other than house prices and at house price inflation per se. And I think the predominant tool that should be used to control booms and busts in housing, I think, should be quantitative rather than price. I think it's a delusion to believe that we can offset these property credit and asset price cycles by moving the interest rate. On the issue of the supply side, the answer is I don't know quite what I think there's some, the crucial thing obviously is I think there has to be a lack of demand. And by the way, one of the problems is that you can't entirely separate demand and supply. If you don't have enough demand in your economy, you have a group of people who are unemployed for a period of time and then they lose skills, and then you have a supply side problem that can be self-fulfilling in what's called this crisis. But I think there are some very strange things happening on productivity. We fundamentally don't understand, which I think might be inherent. I think there may be something about modern economies which proliferate, which achieve. We have this extraordinary productivity paradox. We had it 30 years ago when Robert Solow said computers are everywhere except in the productivity statistics. And it's even more there today, where we talk about automation and robots and a threat to jobs, but we've had no productivity growth, particularly at the macro economy level for the last 10 years. I think what's going on is that for a set of reasons, we are radically automating manufacturing, and I think we're on the verge of radical automation of retailing. But for some reason, when the people, the jobs that people free up from that, they essentially move into a set of low wage, no productivity jobs like delivery drivers. But it's very deep and bluntly, we don't fully understand.
Well, there will always be a general observation in terms of housing inflation, but there was some work done that said that if you earned £17,000 in Liverpool, you needed to earn £40,000 in London to have the same lifestyle.
Yeah.
And this was essential housing and associated costs.
We have time for two very brief questions, providing we also get a very brief answer. Good idea.
My name is Colin Bakes. I'm the president of the Wessex Regionalists Party for Wessex. As the City of London is conspicuously the world's money numbers laundering of choice for criminals around the world, what measures would the speakers propose to root this fundamental poison in Britain?
Could we have one more provocative question?
Thomas Huffman, New Guard City Alliance. What could the panel suggest how we get the land question right, so that we deal with the over collateralization of land? What would be the idea? Is this investment banks, merchant banks, and building societies, or what is your idea?
Thank you. One more question. Yes.
Hi, I'm
Fran
Boait,
the
talk, so this might be a relevant question, but Has there been any discussion today about negative interest rates, negative central bank rates, and how that might impact on government debt?
Okay. Well, that's a very clear question. Those three questions, please.
Negative interest rates essentially makes it easier to fund government debt. That's the point I did mention, that I think the sort of secret of what convention is not doing here is not pure monetary stimulus, it's fiscal stimulus facilitated by monetary accommodation, fiscal stimulus, paper tax poll, which sets out theory. I think negative interest rates and very low interest rates in their pure monetary mechanism may actually have had some perverse effects. There's a very good paper now out by Mark Brunemeyer from Princeton, which points out that, of course, we think of very low interest rates as making people borrow more, but it also means that people who have bank deposits, their income goes down, and they may feel less porous, less rich as a result, they spend less. And we haven't really, there are some interesting ways where beyond a certain level, very low interest rates in their pure monetary mechanism can be ineffective, even while facilitating that. I'll answer, I'm afraid I'm not going to answer the Wessex regional question on that. There's much less monetary laundering than I think goes on in Winchester. I think collateralized lending against property has a role to play in lubricating the exchange of housing assets between people. I think we need it, but I think we allow it to go on in too large a scale. I will have higher capital weights for lending against real estate. They are sometimes incredibly lowly weighted within what's called the Basel II risk weighting aspect. Seen from a bank, it always looks as if the easiest thing to do is lending against real estate. So you have an automatic bias, not your fault, but an automatic bias pulling you in that direction. And I think we can do more to shift it the other way by higher capital rates and limits on loan terms.
So quickly on negative interest rates, definitely really not a good idea. I guess it is more for saving, so it's kind of approach. If your computer isn't working and you're trying to fix it with a hammer, then you're going to get a sledgehammer and see if that is any better. Like, you need to rethink of how money policy works and not just kind of move to desperate for something negative. And there's other lots of side effects that will work as well. Definitely agree we need to increase the capital. Like, one of the issues with it is it's even risky to lend to. It means the real estate, because of the way capital required by patients is set up, so it might incentivize to lend mortgages, which is another good thing. And then finally, on the City of London, I think we really need to have more public scrutiny and how it works and some of the issues with it. There's a conversation about the fact that I think there's a
The remembrance.
Who sits behind the house, the speaker of the house, and is the official person from the City of London. The way the City of London has power over the UK is obviously is going back hundreds of years, and obviously we need to surface that conversation and how it works and how we need to change it. So,
briefly on the laundering, I think the problem solves itself because very quickly you're all coming to the city, you're all doing it on the dark web and Bitcoin. money laundering in the city, I believe, is much less than it was, but the demand is there. On property, just one quick point, there is quite a lot of work being done to produce a formula which stops the escalation of loans to property. In a property boom where people lend more and more, by creating loan to value rates which are a bit like a cape in the 10-year averages rather than or property's worth rather than boom prices as a way of strengthening the leverage. So there is some room to that.
This is, we have to be careful.